Good morning. Every year, the Bloomberg Library Committee presents an update for the library. All of us use the library every single day, almost. And we're very, very lucky that we get to partner with Eccles Health Sciences Library, which does just a phenomenal job, not only for our Bloomberg Library, but also assisting us with the Moran Corps. And so today we're going to be giving an update kind of on what's new in the library and what's new in Moran Corps. This is the library committee. We have a great committee. I think it's one of the best committees to belong to at the Moran Eye Center. We meet every other month and we're doing it now virtually at 7 a.m. And so anybody can attend from anywhere. And I want to thank all of the committee members for all the hard work that everybody puts in to make sure that we are giving you the service that you need to do your jobs. Christy Jarvis, who's on sabbatical right now, is the Associate Director of Scholarly Communications at Eccles Health Sciences Library. And she does all the licensing. I meet with her. We go through all the journals. If there's a journal that we don't have that you want, please let me know because we are able to do that. And she also helps us with many tools for research and teaching and patient care. And unfortunately, she can't be here today, but we're glad that she's our librarian for the Bloomberg. So Nancy Lombardo, I'm going to introduce her as well, is going to give Christy's update on the new ebooks.
Okay, I'm Nancy Lombardo from the Eccles Library, and Christy just wanted to point out that we have quite a number of new ebooks that are relevant to your discipline. And so here are some of the titles that we've obtained this past year. So please go to the ebooks. If you go to the Eccles Library website and the information tools, there's an ebooks entry that will take you to all of the ebooks. We also have some new, some new journals. We have the Advances in Ophthalmology and Optometry, which is New England Journal of Medicine, and New England Journal of Medicine Evidence. So please go to the library and check out these new resources. If you need help, you can get a hold of people at the library. You can call on the phone. There's a instant messaging right on the homepage of the library's webpage. It says, ask a librarian. If you just text right there, somebody will get back to you and help you with a question. You can also email that ehsl-reference@list.utah.edu so you can get a hold of people all of those ways. And you can check our hours also on the website. And then, of course, the Bloomberg Library is open 24 hours.
Now, I'm going to introduce you. You won't introduce yourself properly. Yeah. Because I have to brag about Nancy. Nancy and I have been partners now for over 20 years, but she is really remarkable. She's the head of digital publishing at Eccles Library. She does a lot. She manages the novel library, the Neuro-Ophthalmology Virtual Education Library, as well as a publication called the Nanos Illustrated Curriculum. And she also manages several online journals that the library is now publishing. She is our direct manager of the Moran Corps, Moran Clinical Ophthalmology Resources and Education, as well as all the digital projects that are going on at Eccles. She won the Nanos Merit Award in 2018 for all of her work for Nanos. And in 2017, she won the Medical Library Association's Louise Darling Medal for Distinguished Achievement in Collection Development. We're really, really lucky to have her and her compadre, Brian Hall, here with us today. So Nancy, I'm going to turn this over to you.
Okay, yes. And I do want to point out that Brian Hall is my colleague and really does at least half of the work, if not more. So really grateful to have him on all of these projects. He works on all of these projects with me. So I was just going to introduce a little information about the growth of the Moran Corp project. And so here I have some usage statistics, and these are statistics from the use of the website. And you can see when we first started in 2015, we had very small usage, just over 1,000 sessions. And then in 2021, we had close to 400,000 sessions with 500,000 page views, 320,000 users, and we're serving 217 countries. So we have had users from all around the globe. And these are our current statistics as of June. So we're on a good trend. These are our YouTube statistics. So in 2018, we decided to open the YouTube channel to the public. Until that time, we had had it private and you could only get to the videos on the website. But I think it was a really great change that we made because I think we draw a lot of attention from YouTube. Whenever we have, you can see we have 30,000 subscribers to the YouTube channel. So every time we post a new video, we get a lot of attention. We get a lot of views right away. So it's a really great way to draw people into the site. Every video on YouTube has a little bit of information about the title, the authors, the date, and a link to the Moran Corp collection. So it's a great way to bring people into the website. These were the top 10 videos as of June of 2022. So you can see a lot of these are examinations, but we do keep track of who's getting the most views on the YouTube. These are YouTube statistics again. So you can see we're doing really well. We have a lot of attention. So the more new material that we post, the more attention that we get and the more users that we get. So I wanted to point out how you can submit information to the Moran Corp. So this is the Moran Corp website, and down in the footer, there's a link to guidelines for authors. And so all the information that you need about submitting is there. We'd love to have surgical videos, case reports, narrated PowerPoints, a great image, anything that you see that is very interesting or is a really great example, it would be an ideal thing to submit to the Moran Corp. Things will get peer reviewed and it is considered a publication in an online educational platform. So when you're submitting, if you go to the guidelines for authors, you'll see there's a Moran Corp metadata template and it just asks you for all the information that we need. And then you can send it to this email address and we will then post that. If it's too large, you can use the university's send it email. So just go to that guidelines for authors site for all the information about submitting. And the one thing I like to remind everyone is that we do have to comply with copyright laws. And there is information on the guidelines for authors site about the copyright regulations and what is fair use. The main thing we have to be careful of is images. You cannot take an image from a journal article or even a website without getting permission, unless you get it from a public domain site. Another place where we have had some trouble is music. So some people have added music to their PowerPoints, and if it is copyrighted, YouTube will identify it and they will cut off access to that particular item. So we did lose one item because there was Star Wars music in it. So do be careful about adding music. And any questions about any of that? Yes, so the question was, if you have a talk and you've used an image that you think is copyrighted, is it possible to just remove that image? And yes, you can do that. And if possible, I mean, the Moran iCenter has a fantastic photograph collection. So if you could find something adequate and similar, you could just replace it. And anytime you need images, I would encourage you to go to that Access collection of images that are collected by the photographers here, because you guys have a fantastic collection of images that might work. So, okay, so the question was, if you have a surgical video, do you need to get patient permission to post it? And the answer is only if the patient is identifiable. So if you cannot identify the patient, then we can use those videos. And those are super popular, I will say. People love surgical videos. Thank you. So Dr. Petty has pointed out that in some realms, it is being suggested that both ethically and legally, it's a good idea to get patient permission if you're going to post their video. So that might be something that needs to be decided on a policy level here at the Moran, but it probably is a good idea, but I'm sure we do have a few that probably don't have permission, official permission. So any other questions? Okay, I think Griffin.
So we're really lucky that we have editor-in-chief of the Moran Corps, Griffin Jardine, and he's just going to give a short introduction to the rest of this grand round, which will really highlight the Moran Corps.
Thanks, everybody. It's fun to be with all of you, especially in July. I feel like this is kind of the equivalent of the first day of school for, you know, like for a parent. Like the energy is so just kind of buzzing and fresh. I'll tell you just one kind of funny story about July. So my mom and dad, when they were first married, were living in Washington, D.C., and their first baby was due June 9th. And the doctor said, this is the best time to have a baby in a teaching hospital. The interns and the residents and the fellows are at the peak of their training. And he said, the worst time to have it is in July. And she went on to be 31 days late because they didn't induce back then. So they built this up like this is some big deal, and she had the baby on July 10th, and it went great in spite of, you know, all the new trainees. And so, I always thought it was a funny story, but I think July does have it's great to have so many new our new residents, the PGY2, some the medical students who are rotating with us. We love having you and are happy and excited to support you and your kind of journey through this wonderful profession. A couple of things. Just to reiterate, that submission process, that Moran Corps template is really important. Also, we want you to be as, you know, there's various types of submissions. We do have our medical students writing a lot of articles. As you go to the website, you'll see there's a lot of hyperlinks in the outlines of under each topic. And then there's a lot of things that don't have a hyperlink. And you know, if anybody here is looking to just add to CORE, identifying areas where we don't have content is wonderful, and then using as many images and videos as possible, and then submitting those not as embedded in the files, but as separate attachments, so they're high quality. I just can't tell you how wonderful the library committee, and especially Nancy, has been with this whole process. They're so responsive. They make this so easy for us. We're just really incredibly fortunate to have them. This year, we thought it would be wonderful to hear from our section editors on some of the work they're doing. We've tried to be, in the last year, we've tried to increasingly involve them in our meetings and our brainstorming discussions for the Corps. And they, you know, Kathleen and all of us have been so impressed by their wonderful contributions. And we're so grateful for them to take on this additional role. So thank you to those who are presenting. I was gonna say, Rachel, I don't know if you want to just take a second. Rachel is just going to do just an update on a Duke Moran collaboration. Give you just a minute, and then we'll turn the time over after that to some section editors as well for their kind of own section updates.
Hi, good morning, everyone. This is a very short update because so far this idea is still really kind of just in the idea phase. But Lloyd Williams, who I think a lot of you all know, who was a faculty here at Moran and is now at Duke, has been doing, while he was here, did a lot of work on CORE. And now that he is at Duke, actually wants to continue to do a lot of work on CORE. And we thought it was a great opportunity to collaborate our two institutions. And really, you know, the name of Moran will help elevate Duke from this unknown entity to, you know, maybe a well-respected institution in ophthalmology. So we figured we'd be benevolent and allow them to collaborate with us. And the idea is that this will be kind of like an online surgical curriculum where there's lectures and kind of staged lectures where we're saying for PGY2s, these are really the lectures that you need to know at this stage of training to help you, you know, see patients in clinic, understand what you need to be thinking about when you're signing patients up for surgery, understand what you need to be looking for at the very basic stages of surgery, all the way through to, you know, what a chief needs to know on the day they graduate to go out and feel ready to operate on their own. So that is the idea. Lloyd and I have been kind of working just in the very early development stages. The idea was initially this would fall kind of somewhat under the mole category due to like the didactic nature of a lot of these lectures. And that's kind of where the idea first came from. So right now it's falling under mole, although it will probably end up being more of like a subset with a lot of other surgeons contributing, hopefully. So if we hit you up at certain points over the year for videos or lectures or recorded lectures, anything like that, please know that is where that's coming from. And if there's anyone that's particularly excited to work on this, send me an email. I'm more than happy to share the burden. Yeah, that's it. It's going to be, I think, one of the more exciting things, hopefully, for CORE for this year.
We've had so much success the last couple of years with residents really involving themselves in some of these projects. So again, if there's any interest, please reach out to us. We'll start with Susan Chorkoff, who Dr. Chorkoff will give us an update on her section, who I think she just is a new section editor this year. So turn over to you, Susan.
Good morning. So I was invited to give an update on the glaucoma section of the Moran CORE. I just wanted to start with this quote that really resonated with me from Dr. Jane Durkin's Distinguished Alumni Lecture on Mentorship at our most recent Resident Research Day. And it's from her mentor, Dr. Van Buskirk. From their roots in the ancient world, physicians have always been called on both to heal and to teach, the latter perhaps the most sacred of duties. Healing helps one at a time, but the passing of knowledge reaches millions for generations to come. And I really do think this is the mission of the Moran CORE, is to provide an educational material that is easily accessible and that really showcases Moran's commitment to education on a global scale, really. Since becoming the editor earlier this year, I worked with the librarians to create a more visually appealing web page for our glaucoma section. And I want to thank Jim Gilman for the beautiful optic disc photo there and the librarians for coming up with that format. Next, I worked on the outline, which was originally populated from basically from the American Academy of Ophthalmology Basic Science Series. I wanted to basically kind of expand on what was already there, make it more original and kind of more fresh. The library staff helped to create, we spent a lot of time on how to create a really nice format with this bulleted format here is what we ended up using. I know this slide is busy, and it's only a portion of the actual outline, but I just wanted to show you that. And basically, since then, I've been working on filling in content, and that's really our biggest challenge, is to make sure that we have fresh, accurate content. It's basically the content is usually either a written document, much like Nancy has already gone over, or a videotape lecture, or the surgical videos, which I think really makes the site unique. And then I added some reference pages so that people in the global community have access to what we think are important, free or purchased references. Most of these are through these hyperlinks, which make it really easy to access the information. Our challenges, I just wanted to highlight this most recent submission by Dr. Nakatsuka, and it's just a really beautiful submission. It gives the materials needed, it gives the surgical steps, and then it's a really great video. So thank you to Dr. Nakatsuka, who's been working hard on that. Our challenges continue to be getting the original content and submissions. Other things I've identified as challenges are getting, one particular thing is getting help editing surgical videos. Our surgeons are so busy doing surgery that it's hard to really spend the time to edit them and get them really dialed in so that they can be submitted. And then finally, I think the biggest challenge going forward is, for me, is going to be trying to keep the section updated so that we, things that are out of date get removed, things that we need to make more accurate or remove things that are inaccurate. I think that probably needs to be looked at on a regular basis, and that's one thing I'm working on myself. Most of our contributors are medical students, residents, fellows. We are inviting them and encouraging this year to make submissions, but probably in future years, it's going to be a requirement of our fellowship that there are some submissions made to the Marine Corps. And then our busy faculty especially are helpful in providing those surgical videos. One thing that Dr. Jardine recommended and I think has been really proven to be helpful already is I've created a gap list for glaucoma. So I made a list of everything that's missing within our outline. That's not inclusive, but things that I thought would be a good place to start. And then he or other people can give those to medical students who may be interested in submitting contributions. And then, my little photographs didn't make it. Darn. I wanted to just say thank you to the digital content librarian. Nancy Lombardo and Brian and Carmen Smoot have been really helpful and really are the ones that take our ideas and our content and bring it to the public. So I just wanted to thank them, and then Jim Gilman for photographs. If you do need help with photographic submissions, Jim is great. Ethan Peterson for helping us upload the content to the librarians. And then just Dr.'s degree for inspiration, and Dr. Jardine for his real commitment and dedication to this project.
So the next section editor is Dr. Megan C., who has completely revamped the neuro-ophthalmology section. Megan.
Thank you, Dr. DeGree. I wouldn't say that I completely revamped it. I did inherit it from you, so it was already pretty stellar. So because of that, I don't have a lot of updates this year. We did also kind of spruce up the appearance of it. So this is the homepage. And we divided it out just right there into the broad categories that people can just click on right away and go to exactly what they want. In general, our overall theme is trying to, for the main topics, develop an approach to type of learning item for that, which is often didactic videos, but it could be manuscripts. So you'll see kind of approach to optic nerve pallor. So this is like the first thing a student, resident, or fellow would look at to just learn broadly about that topic. You can see we have a gap there that there's no item. So anyone wanting to create that, we would love to have that. And then we have a lot of case presentations on really each important topic of neuro-ophthalmology. This is just a very short example of optic neuropathy section. Our future goals we'd like. So I worked with Srav Agunta and Amanda Redfern a lot last year when they were fellows to really organize things the best that we that was for learning sake. And what we want to do is develop more PowerPoint case presentations that a learner can go through a case and it has stopping points to where they can think about what they would do next, management wise and treatment wise. And then they move on into the PowerPoint and kind of learn our approach to that particular patient. Always looking to improve organization. And as I said, still have some gaps that need material. So all of you learners out there wanting to get some publications, let me know. And that is it for neuro-ophthalmology.
So one of the sections that residents have really requested is something on optics. And we're really grateful to David Meyer for taking up the baton for this section. So Dr. Meyer, do you want to give us a tour?
It's a bit of an older picture of me. One of my residents saw this picture and he goes, "Hey, I saw you, Dr. Meyer, without a beard and you looked really weird." I was like, "Thanks, that's how I lived most of my life. So I appreciate that." So yeah, we have the optics section and I realize, you know, if you're looking through Moran Core, that's not exactly the most exciting section probably you've ever heard of. I realize it's not quite as exciting as a lot of surgical and neuro-ophthalmological and a lot of other sections, but obviously I'm biased, but we feel like it's really, really important. And for several reasons, which I'll outline. You know, generally the goal here is, and this is basically mirroring what's on the Moran Core website, is to create an open source of education for students, residents, healthcare workers, and clinicians. And really, you know, I work with a couple of residents and one thing I try to pound into their heads is, you know, we try to make this content very, very clinically applicable just to kind of benefit our patients and benefit patients all over the world. You know, a lot of times I go to these academy lectures and they're great and they're interesting, but sometimes I kind of come back to clinic on Monday and I think, okay, what did I learn that I can apply today in clinic? And sometimes I can, and sometimes I can't. And so with the Moran Core, we try to make it so it's something you can apply, you know, this week or today in clinic. I wanted to put a little blurb here. This was a study done in 2021. Undercorrected refractive error remains the largest contributor to global moderate and severe visual impairment in adults aged 50 years and older, with over 86 million individuals, approximately 42% of the 206 million cases of global MSVI. So, I mean, having a kind of this baseline knowledge of optics really is beneficial, especially considering how much moderate severe visual impairment there is in the world. So, you know, this is our section. We need to kind of work a little bit more on kind of making it look a little nicer, but, you know, I'm not going to go through all of this, obviously, but, you know, we have sections on geometric optics, optics in the eye, clinical refraction. And here we have, you know, some videos, you know, about going through a subjective refraction, you know, fitting a contact lens. We have a little section down here on contact lenses. We go through a lot of things, you know, just not just kind of routine, but more specialty stuff. Optical instruments and low vision aids. There are several lectures there. And then finally, the last section is physical optics. We don't have a lot there. We haven't really focused on that too much yet, just because we're trying to make it so clinical that physical optics is something we'll kind of deal with a little bit later as time goes by. And just to kind of show you just a couple of examples, like, you know, we have lectures where we, you know, we're kind of up close and personal with Fropter and saying, you know, this is what we're doing and this is why we're doing it. And, you know, this is the kind of step-by-step thing that you want to look for when you're refracting or anything else. We have lectures that there's Dr. Petty right there that, you know, he's talking about telescopes and this. And so again, we try to make it really, really clinically applicable. And, you know, like I said, I've got a couple of residents that are helping me out with this. And I kind of said there was a section on contact lenses. We even get into things like, you know, aphakic contact lens fitting. We kind of go through that and things to look for and things that, you know, you want to be aware of. And so, you know, we try to make it really general so that, you know, anyone can access it. But also if you want to get into a little bit more specific things, we're trying to get plenty of content for that as well. And then finally, just as our conclusion, again, lots of clinically applicable content. We still have a lot to go. As kind of has been mentioned, videos get the most views and kind of the, you know, a lot of people really, when they want to learn something, they're very visual and they want to see it in a video. So we're kind of working on adding more videos. And then in general, if you go through the section, if any of you have any thoughts on a future direction or a section you really want added, please, you know, don't hesitate. Let me know. I'm happy to hear about it. And I'm happy to help. And, you know, don't hesitate to contact me. And so that's our section. And I appreciate you spending some time.
So thank you very much. Well, one of the newest sections that's been added is the plastic section. And I want to thank especially Dr. Patel for leading the charge for the Moran Corps this year in kind of revamping this whole section. So Dr. Patel.
So I hope you got a chance to read that article I sent you. I purposely sent you a 12-year-old article written by written by Richard Smith, who you may know. He was the editor of the BMJ and the BJO, and with Atul Gawande and a few others. He's regarded to be our modern thinkers in medicine, and I always follow them to see what they're seeing about medicine and how we practice, how it's changing, how we can improve, and so on. Those of you who got a chance to read that paper, I hope you shared my emotions. I got scared when I read it. I was surprised when I read some of the statistics about how many of us actually read papers and keep up to date. And then I got concerned about if it was that busy 12 years ago, the statistics today are absolutely ghastly. I'll tell you something I checked this morning. When Richard wrote this paper in 2010, he Googled information overload, which was coined in 1970, and he came up with 960,000 hits, so just under a million. At 1 o'clock this morning, as I was just doing my final check, the hit was 170 million. We're now talking about, I mean, a scale which is logarithmically higher. And if that's the case with just that phrase, information overload, and you look at some of the medical terms, common medical terms, the data is absolutely humongous. So we've got to bear that in mind as we address the Moran Corps. I have one quick question for Nancy. Do we have the Cochrane database and the up-to-date databases available to the university? Would you be kind enough to put those links somewhere where we can have access? I was trying to find them, but couldn't. And it'd be really lovely. And if there are some other peer-reviewed databases which amalgamate information, it sort of goes, segues with what I'm talking about today. Thank you. So as far as plastics goes, I'll start off by saying I'm not a big fan of just repeating things all the time. Your basic sciences book and the academy books cover the basics of plastics very well. So if one of us goes and puts down exactly ptosis or, you know, dermatocalasis or blepharospasm verbatim, the same information from a book onto the website, it really helps nobody. So we should, my feeling is we should really be adding to the information that we already have. I'm going to take you through just a little video I made, talk you through some of the things we're trying to develop. This phrase of infobesity or data obesity is becoming popular now. We have just so much stuff. If you are studying Ebola, you'll have to read for 50 years without sleeping just to keep up to date with the information. That's one rare disease there. This I found fascinating. Our attention span is now less than that of a goldfish, which is why TikTok decided their best videos are less than 8 seconds based upon this scientific study. So we have this massive, look at the emails. I mean, I get 1400 emails a day. 10 years ago, it was 1/7 the number of emails. This is not even counting the 2 hours extra we do on EMR and patient calling and so on. So how much burden do we have? 90% of all data online has been put on the last 2 years. Another really scary statistic. So are we at Moran Corps guilty of just copying and pasting stuff? Well, I hope we're not. And we should really be updating the information, as Susan and others have said, so that we're up to date. The power of video is demonstrated. I want to thank the neuro-ophthalmology department for this. I looked up at the numbers and they're staggering. The best paper I ever wrote has been read by about 1,000 people. These videos by neuro-ophthalmology, you're now getting into the millions. And I'm absolutely fascinated about the power of the video. And I've always known that, as I'll show you in a minute, but this has really sort of renewed my enthusiasm to put clinical information in video format. So here are the aims of the plastics division. We're going to contribute, we have been contributing original articles which actually add information to what's already in the BCS books. We're using photographs and videos to really help educate people. I'm using Nick Mamelis's amazing pathology slides to sort of correlate with the clinical things that we see, and we're concentrating on long form and short form videos. The Orbital Conference presentations go through a review process just like a publication before they're published. Let me show you, you may get some vertigo, but I wanted to quickly show you how we're adding to common information that is not very well known. Lots of drawings, lots of illustrations. We are putting a vast array of clinical findings so that if you ever want to know what something looks like, I'm going to give you, we're going to give you 30, 40, 50 examples. So you really never have to go anywhere else. With clinical details, we're putting history, we're putting etymology, a price I pay for doing Greek and Latin for 7 years at school. Might as well use it. We're putting rare conditions, common conditions, but we're putting information on top of what you already have. When I was a fellow in London, I made these videotapes with those video cameras, which are the size of a house. And I pulled them out the other day, and they're actually very, very good. So I just need to bring them up to HD quality and retape them. But there were short videotapes that I made for the residents and other plastic surgeons. These days, our residents do not do internal medicine or surgery before they come to us. They're purely from medical school to ophthalmology. And I find they're lacking in basic skills, like how do you handle instruments? How do you hold a needle? How do you suture? So I made these for medical students in those days, but I'm going to upgrade them for the sake of our residents and doctors all over the world, really. And, you know, we're talking about every little nitty gritty. Where do you hold the needle? How do you suture it? What is the best technique? How do you handle the suture itself when it comes through the wound? It may seem simplistic when you actually see the technique. And once you master it, it's almost like a simple thing. I mean, it flows beautifully. So we're making simple videos to do with techniques. How do you identify an instrument? This Friday, we're taping, how do you scrub? I was observing some residents scrub last Friday, and I realized it was horrible, and any nursing officer would throw them out of the surgery theater. So we're going to videotape exactly how you scrub, put it step by step, and it'll be an amazing video because it's not out there. So we've started doing something more sophisticated. The boys and girls in clinic and I did a little study. We went around the clinic one day and asked the other attendings and fellows and residents how you do a Schirmer's test. And we asked about 22 people. Everybody got it wrong, including me. So a simple test, we just assume we should all know how to do. So we made a 2-minute video of exactly how to do it. I'm sort of running through it quite quickly. But now it's up there. You know the steps. You know how to do it. There's no mistake. And the technicians will have access to this as well. So these are what I call short form videos, instruments, techniques, how to identify. And then we're doing long form videos thanks to neuro-ophthalmology and the power of video. So surgical videos are difficult to make because there's blood everywhere and we have to clean it up. And oh my God, editing takes me days to do. And then we put text and voiceover. And considering the information overload and Epic and emails, I don't know where we'll find the time. But my aim is to keep on adding, with the help of my partners, as many videos that are not out there. We're going to be choosing titles and topics that actually add to the educational process so that people will look them up for their individuality. And to finish off with Polsky, my resident currently, we finally gave in and we've joined TikTok. I never thought I'd do that. But short form videos, which give little tips on medical history, which is what I'm a big fan of, or medical data or information which needs to be out there, which we've been doing through Twitter, which is pretty boring. We're going to start doing that as well. So exciting times ahead. I wanted to thank Nancy for helping us. She's allowed me to create a template for many of these presentations. We're working on a video template so that we'll have a similar sequence. And I know I send you these in boluses, and I know it takes you time. I didn't realize how much work you do, by the way. I'm embarrassed at how much stuff I send you to put up there. And if there's anything we can do to make life easier, if we can upload it for you, please let us know. Happy to take any questions. And Kathleen, thank you very much.
Questions? Talk about that information overload. We're all overloaded. Thank you for bringing that to our attention, but we all feel it every day. This project would never, ever, ever happen if we didn't have Eccles Health Sciences Library and the geniuses and experts that we have with Nancy Lombardo, Brian Hall, Carmen Smoot, and a whole team of other people that are there as well. And we're really lucky that we partnered with them early on to make this happen, because this can't happen in a vacuum. And it also can't happen without Ethan Peterson, who's been just a yeoman of getting those videos of lectures up and running, and also Jim Gilman, who manages all the photography, is really incredible. And it can't happen with all of us. So one of the messages that we and our committee have is we want you to be involved. This is our educational resource. We can use it for the core of just having it out there for the world, but we can use it for our MOL lectures. I mean, this is an educational resource that is open to the world. And it's one of the things that I think sets Moran Eye Center apart from all the other eye centers, in that we have developed these wonderful resources in education to promote education. We wanted to leave a few minutes of time for all of you to give any ideas or thoughts about what you'd like to see happen, or any other comments that you have. Yes, Dr. Petty. Well, when you build it, they will come. I mean, that's one thing. Everybody who submits something can use it for other purposes too. You own your own copyright when you submit. So that's the kind of cool thing about this, is if you own your own copyright, you can use it again. And I would urge everybody, when you write a paper or submit it to a publisher, fine, they get the content, but always keep the copyright to your images. Then you can reuse your images whenever you want to, however you want to, and you never have to ask yourself or the publisher for permission or pay to get your images back, which is the most egregious thing, that, you know, here you work so hard and then you have to pay to get your own stuff back. It's just crazy. But anyway, that I think that's really important to remember. Nancy and Brian, do you have any other comments about that? And if you do, come on up here. No, okay. Any other questions or comments? Yes, Dr. Patel.
Quick request to make of all the attendings and residents. So we've also started an image database. So we have plastic surgery images from carcinomas, et cetera, or common things. Of course, I have literally more than a million images, but I'd like you, when you're doing clinics and stuff, if you see something interesting, take your iPhone photograph, email it to me with a little bit of the history, and I will edit it down and with your name, help add these images to our video database. Whenever you search on the internet, it's amazing how many of our images show up first page in Google when we submit it to the Moran Corps. The Moran Corps has become, I don't know who does the SEO. Who does the SEO for Moran Corps? Who does it, Kathleen? Who does the site optimization? Whoever's doing it is doing an amazing job, because we're always number one or two on a Google page with 10 million hits. So please send those images in so we can get our database going. Thank you.
Brian Hall from our, the other Brian. Oh my God. I'm like, okay. I haven't had enough coffee this morning. So we have been very lucky in that we've had in our library team, and I guess I found out that I didn't get the updated list here. I want to point this out. Brian Jones at the top here is been an amazing resource for the Corps because he has done web vision, but he also has helped us understand how to optimize our whole website. And you were really instrumental in getting us right into the, you know, changing up to a YouTube format so that we would increase our stats. But Brian, why don't you tell us a little bit about how this all ends up being kind of a structured increase, right, by Google?
It's pretty straightforward. The way that things were structured in WordPress and the way that we've taken advantage of metadata, and this is all the library that helps add in the metadata. And when you submit content, if you could include appropriate metadata that you would like associated with that, especially your names, if you're authors or creators of the content, this is really important. Google structures search engines. So search at Google is entirely algorithmic. There's search basically comes down to literally like 12 people at Google. And the math algorithms that they use are basically completely automated. And so the idea is you want to help Google help you by structuring the data and presenting the right data that you want the world to see. So all the metadata tags there are absolutely critical for that. And the other really important thing for this, particularly for content creators, is that this is a shockingly good way to get your name out in the community and represent you as experts. So when people go to study section, if you put a grant in, or if people are looking for, you know, to organize meetings, they go to Google. And if they're looking for particular content and your name or your content keeps showing up, this can only be good for your career. So yeah, this is, it's actually a remarkable set of contributions from people that have helped to create an incredible resource. And the YouTube stuff, because Google owns YouTube, is an amplifier for all of this. And so I haven't looked at the stats. I was a few minutes late. Did you cover stats?
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's shocking how, I mean, so WebVision, we figured WebVision was around 1 million visits a year. We're way beyond that with Core now. So
can you predict that?
No, this is exciting.